Rolling, yeah.
Rolling, okay.
Good morning, everyone. How are you?
Good.
Well, my name is Max Steiner. We were the campus irrigation team. I know several of the students have already heard a little bit about our project, but we're going to walk you through the entire semester this morning. So to my right, we have Mesa Thomas, Rebecca Breistad, Wesley Lavender, and Esther Liu. And so just to give you guys a quick idea of what we will be talking about, if the mouse will go.
Arrows?
Awesome. So here's just a quick agenda for what we'll be doing. We're going to touch on the background of the problem, basically how we approached it and how it changed over time. Then we're going to move to our approach. So what we did to construct the model, challenges we faced as it arose, things we dealt with like CAD and other technologies, the technical design of our model. So Wes is going to walk through all the bells and whistles of GAMS and constructing that. The conclusions from the model, so basically the outputs that we use to create our irrigation design, and then finally recommendations to management. So to begin with, the background. So just to give you guys a quick overview, I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with the main quad, so the Dallas Hall Lawn. It's pretty much the most visible part of campus. And just some quick facts, there's 12,000 square feet of grass, an estimated 6.5 million gallons of water per year used in watering. It's the oldest irrigation system on campus, which lends to a lot of problems for the irrigation system itself. So essentially the problem is sprinklers on the lawn tend to water the sidewalks and they don't water efficiently. So there are several implications for this, but pretty much the biggest one that we see is there's a negative impact for SMU as it makes us appear water inefficient. Whether that's to current students thinking that their tuition dollars are going towards watering sidewalks, or for prospective students on campus thinking that we are environmentally conscious, there tends to be a negative connotation with the way that we water, especially on that quad. And so, especially with students being sprayed as they go to class, it tends to be kind of a joke on campus about how we have the healthiest sidewalks around, things like that. And so we wanted to address this both from the standpoint of SMU's image and from the standpoint of efficiency with our resources of water and with cost of the system. And with that in mind, we started to meet with the grounds department actually last semester to kind of wrap our heads around the problem, get it more specifically defined and understand the scope, because we weren't sure if we were going to address the entire campus, one tiny part of campus, what it would look like. And we quickly found that there's a lot that goes into irrigating and that there are actually close to 1,000 irrigation zones on campus. So we confined ourselves to Dallas Hall because that is the most notable part of SMU's campus, and so hopefully we think we'll have the highest impact. But they walked us through their Rainbird system, and so Rainbird is basically an industry standard system for controlling the irrigation of a landscape, and it uses live weather inputs as well as system generated things by the user in terms of soil type and plant type to optimize the amount of water that's being used and hopefully output the right amount every time. So we learned a little bit about that system, but we also learned that the ground staff that's currently on campus is here to maintain the system. They don't have enough staff to freely work on improving it all the time. And there are also restrictions in place from both University Park and Dallas that the system currently is in technically in violation of, but the system's been grandfathered in because of its age. And so they are allowed to water the way they are, but in the future that will phase out. So there are a lot of issues currently with the system. Esther, look at the next slide. We'll touch on those a little more. All right, so our approach, here's Mason.
Okay. So we begin our approach with really just trying to figure out the customer's needs. Because how can we know what to do if we don't have the requirements that they need? So some of the basic things that we wanted to get done was having visual aids of the Dallas quad. It's early. Okay. And no precipitation radius spanning over 40 feet. Right now, most of them span over 55 to 60 feet. And then no watering of the sidewalk, and then head-to-head coverage, with basically just means that the grass is all covered. It's all getting water and it's a good day. So, thanks Esther. The measurements. Before we got into this, there were no measurements of the current design of the quad because all the sidewalks have been eventually created on top of what used to just be grass. And so we went in and we went out there with our lovely measuring wheels provided by Grounds. You may have seen us a lot last semester and the beginning of this semester, rolling around, recording all these measurements. And then we gave them an error of plus or minus 3 inches, depending, just to make sure that we account for that. And we assume that, like, as you're wheeling these, they're as straight as possible. Because sometimes they can get a little skewed, like in direction with the leveling of the ground, you never know. And so from there, we took these measurements and we first were like, okay, this visual aid, let's try to get one done in CAD. That way it can be used for the future from everyone. And so one thing we found in CAD was obviously we have no necessarily advanced training in it. And so we went in and tried to do it, but there were some issues with having curves. You don't necessarily think of all these curves on campus and all of the different grass panels on that quad, but there are a lot more than we assumed. And then to scale as possible. So what happens is when there are the few inches off at that level, when you try to get it in CAD and try to scale it down, the magnitude of that error just becomes bigger because you're doing it all together. And so we just wanted to make sure that we accounted for that. And I mean, it looks like the quad, but obviously there are some errors, and we have a direct measurements and a to scale drawing of it provided for y'all in our report. And so now I'm gonna give it off to Rebecca to talk about our head-to-head placement.
So once we were done gathering all the necessary data, we started to really solve the problem. So the first step of how to do this was we had to figure out how to place the sprinkler heads on the different panels. We were given 4 major requirements that we had to meet when we were doing this. First of all, every panel had to be sufficiently covered so that there was no area of grass that was not watered. Second, we could not get any water on any of the hardscapes or the sidewalks. Third, it was recommended that we use heads that would spray at 40 feet or less, because the grounds department told us that was the ideal length for the system that we were working with. And then also we were supposed to use head-to-head coverage as much as possible. And if Max, if you could click. These red dots sort of illustrate head-to-head coverage. Basically what it means is that every head will spray to the distance of the adjacent heads so that every area of grass will be covered by at least 2 different sprays. And this is a common best practice among irrigations because it's just the most efficient way to effectively water all of the grass. So then after we did the, So our first thought was that we'd try to optimize head-to-head placement in some way, but we soon realized that this was not feasible because there were an endless amount of ways we could have done this. There was no restrictions given to us as far as how many heads we could put on each panel, what distance we should place them apart, and there was no restriction that we had to use the same type of head on every panel. So we realized that our efforts were not going to be effectively utilized by trying to optimize head placement. So we just went ahead and used standard practices for placing the heads, and we optimized our next step, which was pipe placement. We then had to go ahead and figure out how to connect every head that we placed with the main valve, which is the source of all the water. And there was a different ways we could have done this. We wanted to make a network that would be the most efficient and utilize the least amount of piping. So to do this, we had to get some more data. First of all, we had to calculate the distance between every head and all the feasible heads that the pipes could connect to create an efficient network. And we also had to get the GPM, or gallons per minute, required of every sprinkler head. And this varied depending on what type of sprinkler head was chosen, as well as the distance that which you wanted it to spray. So once we got that information, we were able to build a model that would tell us the most efficient way to make the pipes. And then after we built the model, we did a feasibility check based on other factors to make sure that our solution was the best one. So now I'll turn it over to Wes, who will go through the model for you.
Okay, so for our model, we use a piece of software called GAMS. And it's an optimization software. It's used at SMU in some classes, and it can be used for any kind of programs, linear, nonlinear, whichever. And so we were using this software to develop a model that could optimize the aeration pipe layout. And so our objective was to minimize the total pipe distance. We weren't concern was specific cost, and so we didn't look into all the costs of pipes. And so we just looked at the total pipe distance, because less pipes will naturally equal less cost. And so the inputs into the model are obviously the pipe distance. And so we measured all the possible pipes that could be placed between heads and measured that distance. We just used inches on graph paper and then inputted that into the model. And then we also used gallons per minute demand for each sprinkler head. And so that's, each sprinkler head requires a certain amount of water, and it's measured in gallons per minute. And so we placed a demand for each sprinkler head for that. And then we inputted into the model all the possible different pipe combinations. And so the model had many different pipes to choose from, but it would only choose one certain path for each head. So the outputs of the model would be the total pipe distance, which we're trying to minimize, and then the total gallons per minute used by the panel, which would actually just be the initial gallons per minute coming out the valve. And then finally, what we were really looking for, that was the optimal pipe layout to meet the gallons per minute demand of all the heads. So here is a visual mathematical statement of all the of the entire model. And so it's simplified here so that you can see just the generic outline of it. So I'll try to walk you through this a little bit. If I can use this. There we go. Okay, so we're trying to minimize distance. And so that's just going to be the sum of pipe is a binary variable, which is just a 1 or a 0 saying build this pipe or don't build this pipe. And so for every pipe that the model says to build, multiply that by the distance. So you only get the distance for the pipes that are going to be built and not the pipes that are not going to be built. So then, subject two, these are all the constraints for the model. First one is flow balance. And this pretty much just takes the sum of all the flows coming into a head and adds the supply that that head has, and makes it equal to all the flows going out of the head plus the demand for that head. So you don't get a situation where you send a bunch of water to one head, but then it only sends a little bit of water out, because in real life that makes no sense at all. The next one is pipe limitation. And so this was something saying, so the sum of all the pipes that will lead to that head plus the sum of all the pipes going away from that head had to be less than or equal to 3. So that means so a head can only be attached to one pipe, really, in real life. And so we wanted only one pipe coming to the head and one pipe leading out. And the reason we did 3 instead of 2 is that the very first head that we'll receive from the valve will receive one extra pipe, but all the other heads will only have one coming in and one going out, and then there could potentially be a connection, which would be like a T-shaped connection. And then one of the last ones, construct or don't construct. This is what I was talking about with the pipe variable. Is this 1 or a 0? And so this ensures that the flow over a certain pipe will it'll either have flow or it won't have flow. So the upper bound is the limit on that flow. So if the model says don't construct this pipe, then the upper bound will be 0. So it'll ensure that you don't send any water over that pipe. So essentially that pipe doesn't exist. And the last one is lower bound. This is just to make sure that the flow over a pipe is at least the minimum that it has to send. And this is, the lower bound is based on the gallons per minute for all the sprinkler heads that pipe will eventually lead to. Finally, all variables have to be positive. And like I said, that pipe one is just a 0 or a 1. So I'll pass on to Esther now to talk about our output.
Okay, so essentially what we did was we ran that model through for all 37 panels that we developed over the course of our project. And we ended up with something like what you can see over there on the lower right. And And so what this ideally was is the thoughtful pipe layout showing how there were pipes connecting all the heads from a valve, and that all the heads were touched by at least one valve, and that all of them were fulfilled in terms of GPN demand. And then after we did that, as Rebecca explained earlier, we then determined the pipe sizes based on GPN flow, which was already included within our model. And then we did a basic feasibility check in terms of PSI, just by starting from the farthest away head and seeing if there was enough pressure at that head to cover it, because if there wasn't at that head, then the rest of them may not be, and if there was enough at that last farthest head, then obviously all the other ones would be covered as well. And so if you look at the diagram over there on to your right, essentially what we did, we started from a valve, and then we connected all the pipes based on the model's output, and then drew in whether or not there was a need for different pipe sizes. And you can see there's like 3/4 inch and that kind of thing, and those are all representative of what pipe sizes we ended up going with. And then another analysis that we did after we finished doing that pipe layout just to test for feasibility was to analyze whether or not all the panel or all the grass was really being covered. And so basic practice is just analyzing whether or not there's a flooding or a drought possibility by looking at the entire panel of grass and seeing whether or not how many heads were covering each piece of grass. And so as you can see through this lovely color-coded graph that Rebecca made, is that the areas that have 3, for instance, written inside were covered by 3 different heads, places 1 were only covered by 1 head. And though we weren't really positive exactly as to what would constitute as flooding or drought, we decided to write it all out so that the irrigation team could actually make the expert decision on whether or not this was feasible or not. And making it more feasible would simply just, or making it feasible would simply just be a matter of adding extra heads or removing certain heads. And so basically our final recommendation based on our entire project was to first perhaps go find an expert irrigator who could just verify our results and look over the system and see what their recommendation was, and then design a new system based on our recommendations on our model and also the recommendations of a lead irrigator or an expert irrigator, and then design a new system from that. And lastly, we really think that this new system should be implemented as soon as possible because we see the opportunity for major savings and also much efficiency and just overall making SMU seem like a better campus. Are there any questions?
I have some comments.
Sure.
First of all, like Max mentioned earlier, we've worked with this group for a year-ish, is that right? And I've been impressed by your professionalism throughout the entire process, and I'm very impressed by the results, and I would hire you all. I think something we didn't talk about initially that I see value in now would be a map of the pipe layout, because we are asked all the time by Ducky Bobs and different groups that set up tents and need to stake in the ground where the pipes are, and can they have a map so they know what spot to not stake in, and we have no maps for any zone on campus. They're all, they've been repaired and installed for decades, and you know, we don't know what's under the ground until it's hit. So that's another value that you put out in this that we could definitely use in a real life situation.
So nice job. I like your model. It's a minimal spanning tree problem, right?
Essentially, we were trying to design it from the standpoint of a network flow problem, but it essentially came down to a minimal spanning tree anyway.
So is there a constraint in your model that takes into consideration the maximum distance that you put on one of the lengths of these entire trees? So in other words, in my house, I know I can run only about 8 or 10 heads on one zone. If I add more heads beyond that, then there's not enough pressure behind there to allow the sprinkler heads to do what they're supposed to do.
Right. What's the truth?
There's not one, because what we understood from the irrigation team is that the system out here has pretty much plenty of PSI, and so there's plenty of pressure. Right now the system, like they're saying, runs like 40, 50 foot sprinkler heads, so they're taking up a lot of PSI.
most of our heads are way under that, shooting 20, 30 feet max. And so PSI was never really a big concern with us. Like I said, we verified it after the model, so it was kind of hard to implement in the model. But no, there was nothing specific in the model on.
Okay. And just one other question, if I can. Did you do any kind of cost analysis? So you showed 6.5 million gallons of water that was being used. Do we know how much was being wasted? Do we know what the new cost of the new system might be? Newspapers know how environmentally conscious we are here on campus.
We actually didn't end up doing a cost-benefit analysis, but the reason was we essentially found that we could contract it out to a firm that would actually implement the system, and they would be able to do it for us very quickly, as opposed to us taking our time where we've never done a cost-benefit analysis to do that. So we just decided to focus on actual model creation as opposed to cost-benefit. But it would be pretty easy to do in terms of if you took the square footage of the hardscape out of the rest of the model. It just wasn't our, in terms of our timetable, our top priority.
Well, I would hope that maybe this is something we can do for the campus to, you know, again, highlight not only the students doing a project like this, but if there's some cost savings, you know, that that can be shown. The newspapers love these kinds of stories.
Yeah. They had originally wanted this project to include the cost and presenting to stakeholders on the other side of campus the proposal with a dollar number and try to present it as a project that we would actually push through in the next year or so. And at our recommendation, we did want to focus just on the design for this phase. And then the way we handle projects that we contract out, we would take our scope of work, present it to, in this case, probably three different companies, and have them come back to us with their estimate. We work that way. So that's what I had told the group we would like to do, see their scope and then put it out. We'll fine tune as the next phase and then put it out to bid.
Yeah, just as a kind of follow-up to that, on the minimum spend, just on the algorithm side, did I see in there that you actually put in the potential lengths, too? So in that putting those in, maybe you had some that weren't violating the length, or you already intuitively put it in. Did I see that or not?
You mean for each pipe?
Yeah, I thought there was some point in there you kind of, it's like you wouldn't allow it to do ridiculous connections, right? You put in some that were reasonable.
We actually gave it explicit lengths for each pipe that was possible. So those were the only lengths it had to choose from. It couldn't expand that or go lower than that. And so it had explicit pipe lengths to choose from, and so it just chose those. And its goal was to minimize distance so it wouldn't get out of control.
Well, I will add to Ann's comment that you have been incredibly, you've been professional, you've been diligent, all the way out with the wheel and doing your effort to get your data that you needed. So great effort on this project.
Thank you.